2021 is the 25th anniversary of the Telecommunications Act of 1996, the last comprehensive update to internet regulation. The internet has experienced more than a few updates since 1996, but internet regulations have not. That's why Facebook supports updated regulations on key issues like preventing election interference, protecting people's privacy, reforming Section 230, and more. See Facebook's progress on key issues and what's next at about.fb.com/regulations.
At Tillamook, our cheesemakers don't just make cheese, they speak cheese. Our ice cream scientists, they live to brainstorm new flavors.
I dub the malted cookie almond fudge.
Even our customer service team, there's nothing they'd rather talk about than whatever you'd like to talk about.
Tillamook, this is Jazz speaking.
That's because at Tillamook, it's not so much a job as it is a way of life. This is Tillamook. Do right by every bite. Find out more at Tillamook.com.
You've heard the screamers, the shouters, the haters, the beraters. Now it's time to listen to real conversation. Rational conversation. Now it's time for the Rick Unger Show. And now, here's Rick Unger.
We have a deal. This reminds me of the days we used to get an awful lot done up in the United States Congress.
Neither side got everything they wanted in this deal. That's what it means to compromise.
We didn't get everything we wanted.
No one got everything they wanted in this package. We all gave some to get some.
There won't be an infrastructure bill unless we have a reconciliation bill.
Joe Biden announcing with seemingly great pleasure that he had indeed reached a bipartisan agreement with the bipartisan group from the Senate for an infrastructure bill. Now, I included some other clips in what I just played for you to give you a better sense, if you will, of the kind of thinking that went into it. But at the end of the clip, I played something else for you, something that I think is very important. It's Nancy Pelosi making it very clear that, yes, this is all very exciting that we have a bipartisan agreement on an infrastructure bill, but let me warn you, that bill will never become law if we don't have, at the same time, a reconciliation package that will get through the meat of what President Biden had offered up in the first place, right? The trillions of dollars. This one is hundreds of billions of dollars. So that left me wondering, why did Joe Biden find it necessary to say this?
But I expect that in the coming months this summer, before the fiscal year is over, that we will have voted on this bill, as well the infrastructure bill, as well as voted on the budget resolution, and that's when they'll. But if only one comes to me, I'm not. If this is the only thing that comes to me, I'm not signing it.
Well, that certainly set off a whole bunch of trouble. And welcome to a Monday edition of the Rick Unger Show. Hope y'all had a great weekend. So, on the one hand, the president says, I'm thrilled that we've got a bipartisan agreement on infrastructure. But if it doesn't come to my desk for signature in tandem with that reconciliation bill that's really going to deal with much of what I really wanted to get here, well, effectively, I'm going to be vetoing it, apparently. Well, that got all the Republicans crazy. And quite frankly, you can't really blame them. On the one day, he's saying this is wonderful. On the next day, he's saying if I don't get the rest of what I want, then I'm not signing this bill. Now, what made this somewhat remarkable to me is that he didn't need to do it. He really didn't need to do it. And yes, he did walk it back over the weekend, but it was never necessary for him to say this. Why? Because Nancy Pelosi already had. Nancy Pelosi made clear that she will not send such a bill, the bipartisan infrastructure bill, to the president from the House of Representatives if it doesn't also go with the reconciliation bill that provides trillions of dollars for what we're calling human infrastructure. It's confusing why the president even went there. So maybe our guest can help us to sort this whole thing out. We are joined by senior reporter over at The Hill, Alex Bolton, who's been covering this story right from the beginning of the infrastructure negotiations. Alex, welcome to the program. Good to have you.
Thanks a lot for having me.
So maybe you can answer that question. I find it somewhat odd that President Biden went ahead and said what he said, that threw all of this into confusion with respect to suggesting that if he didn't have a reconciliation bill, a budget bill to go along with the bipartisan infrastructure bill, well, he wasn't going to sign the bipartisan bill. The reason I found it confusing is that Nancy Pelosi, in my view, had already taken care of that job for him. She had already said, if we don't have that budget bill, which is where all the money really is, the one that's going to have to be passed, if it is passed, by reconciliation, she says she's not even going to send the bipartisan infrastructure bill over to the White House. So why do you think the president made that statement that he had to walk back?
Well, because I think the president is hearing from progressive Democrats like Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth, a bunch of outside groups, that they're worried, they're very worried that if this kind of scaled down, and it's not scaled down, it's still $1 trillion, 5-year bipartisan infrastructure package, which doesn't raise any taxes, if that passes, that you're not going to have then the political capital to get what the Democrats really want to do, which is, you know, a much bigger infrastructure spending bill, which would include all this so-called human infrastructure, expanding Medicare, a lot more money for child a long-term home health care. I mean, a panoply of priorities. Oh, climate change legislation. Right. And the other part of that, don't forget, is, you know, tax increases, especially on the wealthy. That is a major Democratic priority. So the progressives are really worried, and they've been complaining for weeks, that if that scale-down package gets passed first, the bipartisan ones, could be tough to get all 50 Democratic votes in the Senate, and you may have some moderate Democratic defections in the House to pass, as you said, that bigger budget bill that has their priorities. So the president is hearing this pressure. He hears this concern. And essentially, I think he went off script, and he tried to, you know, I mean, for going off script and kind of putting his foot in his mouth, that's exactly what happened. He said, hey, I'm not signing one without the other. Well, then right then and there, he made an explicit linkage. And so then he's now then changing the terms of the deal. And so that's why then over the weekend, the president had to walk it back and say, the bottom line is I gave my word. I fully stand behind this infrastructure deal without reservation or hesitation. But he's really saying two different things, because what he said only a few days earlier was, well, I'm not going to sign this deal until I get these other things that I want. Right. That's not, you know, that's kind of as if you sign a contract with someone and then you realize, oh, there's a hidden section here. There's an undisclosed section that's operative. I didn't know that was going to happen. So that's the uproar. And why is Biden doing it? Because he's trying to please two very different constituencies, moderates and Republicans, and also the progressive Democrats.
Yeah, I think that lays it out very well. But, you know, from a political point of view, I got to ask you, don't the progressives find themselves in a bit of a problem here? Because now it would seem to me that with that reconciliation bill or not, Biden needs to sign and is going to sign this physical infrastructure bill. He said he supports it all. You know, we don't have to cover all that again. It's not really going to be up to Joe Biden as to whether or not he gets that reconciliation bill. It's going to be up to Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema. So do the progressives find themselves in a pickle here, or will they try and manage this by trying to put together enough progressive votes to kill the infrastructure bill? So if they don't get what they want, nobody gets anything.
Well, so the way I think it's playing out is that the progressives certainly want to kill this bipartisan infrastructure bill, but they don't want to kill it by voting against it, because if they vote against it, then, you know, it's bad news for the Democratic Party. It means that Biden can't keep his people together. It means that progressives are stabbing Biden in the back. I mean, there are a whole bunch of nasty storylines there. So they themselves don't want to vote against and kill the deal, but they want it dead. And probably the best way for them to do that is to demand essentially an assurance that I think they suspect, or they believe, that if they do get that assurance, it's going to be tough for the Republicans to support the bipartisan package. And that's exactly what we're seeing play out. They're demanding an assurance, and then once Biden gives it to them, well, then the Republicans are like, we may not support this thing after all. And so then all of a sudden the package is in danger, and then Biden has to backpedal and says, no, I will support it, trying to, get that deal over the finish line. So believe me, if the progressives could kill it without having their fingerprints on it, they would. And I think they're doing a pretty good job of really undermining it, even though, if it actually comes to the floor, I think, almost all Democrats vote for this package.
So let me set this up, and then we're going to take a break, and we'll get into this in the next segment. It sounds to me, as you describe it, we are very likely to end up with nothing here. We're likely to end up with no physical infrastructure improvements that are in the bipartisan bill, and we're likely to end up with no improvements to human infrastructure. Don't give me your response on that. Let me get to a break. When we come back, we're going to continue this discussion about, to me, has been one of the craziest programs to get bills through for infrastructure, something that tends to be popular with the American people. Just the craziest thing I've ever seen. We will continue with Alex Bolton, senior reporter at The Hill, when we continue with the Rick Unger Show right after this.
Call Rick now, 833-711-7425. That's 833-711-RICK.
2021 is the 25th anniversary of the Telecommunications Act of 1996, the last comprehensive update to internet regulation. The internet has experienced more than a few updates since 1996, but internet regulations have not. That's why Facebook supports updated regulations on key issues like preventing election interference, protecting people's privacy, reforming Section 230, and more. See Facebook's progress on key issues and what's next at about.fb.com/regulations.
Hey guys, Jordan here from the Jordan Harbinger Show. Have you tried the Starbucks Triple Shot Energy, the extra strength coffee beverage in a can? The coffee that you love from Starbucks, ready to drink, offered in classic flavors and now in zero sugar. Four core flavors, vanilla, dark roast, cafe mocha, and caramel, and two zero sugar flavors, black and vanilla. Zero sugar and dairy free. What gives you energy? Find your Starbucks Triple Shot Energy online or at your local store.
At Tillamook, our cheesemakers don't just make cheese, they speak cheese. Our ice cream scientists, they live to brainstorm new flavors.
I dub the malted cookie almond fudge.
Even our customer service team, there's nothing they'd rather talk about than whatever you'd like to talk about.
Tillamook, this is Jazz speaking.
That's because at Tillamook, it's not so much a job as it is a way of life. This is Tillamook. Do right by every bite. Find out more at Tillamook.com.
You, at this very moment, are listening to an incredible radio station that supports The Rick Unger Show and real political conversations. That is something so rare in the American media today. We thank them for carrying this show and investing in rational radio. But you know, not everybody can listen to the entire show, and not everyone can tune in every day. That is why we've launched The Rick Unger Show Premium Podcast. Don't miss a single day of the thoughtful, solutions-based conversations that we strive to have on this program. Go to rickungershow.com, click on Premium Podcast, and get a monthly subscription. You'll get full access to every show we produce, or you can sign up for a year of The Rick Unger Show and save over 30% off the monthly price. Go to rickungershow.com, click on Premium Podcast at the top of the page, and sign up today. That's rickungershow.com, Premium Podcast, and make sure you get your daily dose of rational radio.
I'm Dr. Andrew Jacobs. As a sports psychologist with 40 years of experience, I've worked with athletes, coaches, parents, and officials, assisting them at learning how to handle issues like sportsmanship, developing a positive, realistic attitude, and achieving their maximum performance. I want more people to know about the importance of having fun and that winning is about doing your best. That's why I created the Sportsmanship Foundation, a 501c3 educational organization dedicated to educating parents and athletes about the role of good sportsmanship. Our priority is to help bring the fun back into youth sports. If you're interested in learning more or making a donation, go to winnersunlimited.com and click on the link for the Sportsmanship Foundation on the front page. That's winnersunlimited.com, doing your best, having fun, and becoming a winner. The Sportsmanship Foundation at winnersunlimited.com.
This is Rick Unger, and I want to thank you for listening to the Rick Unger Show Daily Podcast. Now, to listen to the full show ad-free, go to rickungershow.com and click on Premium Podcast at the top of the page.
Get real, get rational, get Rick, The Rick Unger Show.
Welcome back to the Rick Unger Show on this Monday edition. If you are just joining us, we have been talking about the strange few days that have recently passed where we saw Biden unconditionally support the bipartisan infrastructure bill, only to suggest a day later that, well, maybe it's not so unconditional after all, because if he doesn't get a budget bill, which would be passed through reconciliation, giving him the rest of what he had asked, what we call the human infrastructure part of the bill, that he wouldn't sign the bipartisan bill. Well, of course, the Republicans freaked out. The president had to walk it back over the weekend, and who knows where this stands. We are joined in this discussion by Alex Bolton, senior reporter at The Hill. Alex, before we went to break, and thank you for staying with us for some additional time. Before we went to break, I had raised, based on your explanation of what's really going on here, how the progressives really do want to kill the bipartisan bill. They can't necessarily do it with their vote. And so they're putting this in a position where the Republicans will be forced to kill it if they believe that it's going to lead to this reconciliation bill, which is way too expensive for their taste. What that all says to me is that we end up with nothing, because I would think if that's what's going on, the scenario plays out this way. The Republicans do end up wanting to kill that bill, or if they are convinced that Joe Manchin is not going to go along with reconciliation, maybe they don't. But if they are not convinced, if they think that that reconciliation bill could be a reality, I think your assessment is right. I think they themselves will deny an administration bipartisan victory. If that happens, I would foresee Manchin taking a point of view, well, if we're not going to do the bipartisan bill, we've accomplished nothing. I'm not going to support reconciliation. And we end up with zero. Do you see that as being the track that we're on?
No, I really don't, because, you know, the Democrats know they got to get something done. So if the bipartisan package fails, and then let's say you can't get the reconciliation passed right away, if you can't get any agreement on that, I even think that's unlikely, because I think if the bipartisan package, I think the bipartisan, you know, negotiations will, you know, they'll continue to simmer along at some level or another, because if you don't get that first package passed, then the Democrats know they've got to get something done. You can't just do nothing during Biden's first, you know, in office. That would be a huge failure. But I think what the progressives are betting is, it's if you're going to do one thing, it's better to have a reconciliation package than to have, and even if it's not everything we want, the progressives want. I'm not including myself in them, but I'm speaking for them. If it's not everything progressives want, at least it's going to be more than the bipartisan package. I think what the progressives are really concerned about is that if you pass the bipartisan package first, it's really going to right away constrain what you can put in the reconciliation package, because the things in the bipartisan package are the things that are the most popular, are the easiest to explain. You can use it to justify all sorts of other policy changes. And so it's really the engine that pulls all that freight on the train across, you know, up the hill and into the station. So if that bipartisan package collapses, yeah, Manchin will be grumpy, but he knows, and all the Democrats know, they got to get something done. And so, you know, there is still a lot of time left. There's a year and a half roughly before the election. So I'm sure they will get something done. And if the bipartisan package fails, they will, you know, they're going to get something in the reconciliation package. But, it won't be everything that Biden wants, the whole $4.1 trillion agenda, but it'll certainly be something. And so, you know, you say, well, you could see nothing happening. I mean, there are Republicans I've talked to who share that view here in the Senate. But I think ultimately the Democrats know that they got to get something passed. And something by reconciliation will get passed. It may not be what the progressives want.
So basically, it would be starting at square one, except now you take the physical and you add back in the human, and you do it all through reconciliation, or at least to the extent that you can get it through. One of the things that really seems to have the progressives teed off as you look at the bipartisan bill is it pretty much removed anything having to do with climate change. Is there anything you can envision here where something could not be passed to deal with some of those issues? It's not in the bipartisan bill.
I think something in climate is going to pass. And I think there are a lot of Democrats who are insistent that something pass. They have the reconciliation process. Joe Manchin's not going to, stop. He's done a lot already. He slowed it down significantly, and he's, given the bipartisan talks a lot more oxygen than I think folks really thought. I mean, these talks were supposed to be confined to March. I'm sorry, were supposed to be confined to May. We're already heading into July, and they're going to keep on going on. So, Manchin's has already gotten a lot. He's already been given a lot of leash. So, I don't see him blocking the entire reconciliation package. There are things in the reconciliation package that are good for West Virginia. Whether Congress passes a package or not, coal is on its way out as an energy source. That's a problem for West Virginia. The reconciliation package would have a lot of money for West Virginia to transfer to transition workers to newer energy industries to get them better situated with the new economy, the new economy that's leaving coal behind. So, it's dumb for Manchin to block this purely out of spite. His state takes a lot of money takes a lot of federal dollars, and they're going to get a huge share of whatever this reconciliation package is going to be. So, ultimately, he wants the bipartisan bill to pass, but if it doesn't pass, he will still vote for the reconciliation, whatever it is.
Interesting analysis. In the very short time we have left, Alex, how much damage do you think this is doing to the Democratic Party? You really see some pretty obvious fault lines here.
Well, I think really what the central tension is that Biden sees his brand as, a bipartisanship brand, and that he ran in 2020 as someone who's going to bring bipartisanship back to Washington, kind of restore normalcy to Washington. That was his whole, thing. And he got elected, and if he can deliver on that, that would be huge for him. So that's his reelection strategy. But that's not a goal really shared by Democrats, writ large. I'm talking about the Democrats here in Congress. What they want are the big, bold changes. They see this as a moment to transform the United States in a way that'll last for decades, and that's where they're going. So they're kind of on two different pages there. The number of Democrats who feel a political interest in striking a bipartisan deal, there are only a few of them. Joe Manchin, who probably won't run again. John Tester of Montana probably won't run again. Kyrsten Sinema, and Mark Kelly of Arizona, and then Maggie Hassan of New Hampshire. So the number of Democrats who kind of share Biden's, appetite for bipartisanship up here in the Hill, only a few, whereas the number who want the big, bold change and, massive influx of federal money into the U.S. economy to kind of transform the U.S. economy and U.S. society, many more Democrats on that page.
Alex, I got to leave it there, unfortunately, because I'm out of time. Some fascinating analysis, really, really useful, and we appreciate it. Alex Bolton, senior reporter at The Hill. Alex, again, thanks so much for the insight.
Thanks a lot for having me.
You got it. We will continue with the Rick Unger Show right after this.
Want a rational conversation? Call 833-711-7425. 833-711-RICK.
And now, State of Play with former Washington, D.C. Mayor Sharon Pratt.
I've had very rich conversations around the issue of voting rights and D.C. statehood. D.C. statehood and voting rights, they're practically inseparable. And what we heard from the Democratic political leadership is that they care deeply about voting rights, D.C. statehood, but not so certain that they can make it happen in this political climate. But we also heard from the activists, they don't want to hear that. And everybody says Republicans are absolutely clear. They're going to hang on to their power by whatever means necessary. So it would appear to me we're in store for a lot of political unrest in our country in the days ahead.
For more, watch State of Play TV Saturdays and Sundays at noon, 11 Central on the Black News Channel, or go to State of Play TV on YouTube.
Thanks for listening to the Rick Unger Show Daily Podcast. You can hear the rest of the show ad-free by going to rickungershow.com and clicking on Premium Podcast at the top of the page.
Dry eyes? It might be me, inflammation. Those over-the-counter eye drops typically lubricate your eyes and may provide temporary relief and probably won't touch me.
Ask your doctor about Xiidra, a prescription eye drop used to treat the signs and symptoms of dry eye disease. It works differently by targeting a source of inflammation that can cause dry eye disease. It can provide lasting symptom relief.
Xiidra, now!
Don't use if you're allergic to Xiidra. Common side effects include eye irritation, discomfort, or blurred vision when applied to the eye, and unusual taste sensation. Don't touch container tip to your eye or any surface. After using Xiidra, wait 15 minutes before reinserting contacts. See our ad in Travel and Leisure magazine. Call 1-877-4-Xiidra or visit Xiidra.com.
Sun, surf, and seduction collide as four Americans return to exotic islands, hoping their sexy romances can turn into forever. Love in Paradise, the Caribbean, a 90-day story, streaming now only on Discovery+. Start your free trial. Terms apply.